in vain. And then I proudly answered, all of self and none of thee. And because of that, you see, you look around, some people are not here because it's all of self and none of him. They want to serve the Lord in their own town and not God's town. But for a heart that is none of self, to them, all is yielded on the altar. But the passionate Savior is still pleading. And the writer here says, yet he found me, and I beheld him. I saw him bleeding on the accursed tree, and heard him pray, Father, forgive them. And my wistful heart said faintly, some of self and some of thee. Now that I see you bleeding for me, a little for you, a little for me. But the Lord that will never give up, day by day, his tender mercy, healing, helping, full and free, sweet and strong, and that in a patient way, brought me lower. Conviction is coming in. And then I whispered, less of self and more of thee. Paul the apostle, at the beginning of his walk and journey with the Lord, having gone some distance, having gone some miles, looked back and said, all that were gain unto me, I count but loss. But then the farther he goes away from those things I left behind, the less of them he saw. The farther he went, and he got to a point, he looked back and he said, those things were not just lost, but they were dung. They were trash. They were necessary. They were baggage in my life. And so the songwriter says, higher than the highest heaven, deeper than the deepest sea, Lord, thy love at last hath conquered. Grant me now my heart. Now he's praying. Now he's pleading. Now he's asking, Lord, this is my heart desire. None of self, but all of thee. May the Lord grant us this desire in Jesus' name. May the Lord make these our desires in Jesus' name. At this moment, we are going to go into the next message. The next message is the purpose and the power of music. If you are here today, it's because I've been called into the ministry. And I told us earlier when we started in the morning that the world continues to glorify the God of this age with all kinds of music. And unfortunately, there are some that even started in the church that ended in the world, just for the sake of what they were going to gain. Understand, the theme for this retreat is integrity. If you look at your program, it's there on it. It's integrity. Integrity in ministry. Integrity in singing. Integrity as a believer. We, as God's people, are to sing with integrity. We are to sing with distinction. We are to sing for the glory of the name of the Lord. We are to sing not for self-gratification, not for self-glorification. The purpose of being in the choir is not for us to be seen. It's not for fashion purposes. The purpose of singing is to honor the Lord. The purpose of singing is to be a blessing to our generation. The purpose of singing is to leave a mark in the life of people. So then we must join the assemblies of those who with edifying music prepare souls for eternity, the life hereafter. I told us earlier that all over the world, regardless of our culture, race, or background, people praise God in different ways and form. And so we're here to praise the Lord. We're here to honor the Lord. We're here to appreciate the Lord. And I tell you, you know, the Bible tells us in the book of Psalm 19 that the heavens declare the glory of the Lord. The heavens declare the glory of the Lord. I don't have time to get into real nature and tell you how different aspect of nature sings praises to the Lord. We are just one of the creatures of God. Every creature of God honors him, glorifies him, adores him, appreciates him. Listen, and that is why I know some of us may not understand. Jesus said, if people of his time will not praise God, even the stone that will tell you, the stones will rise up and begin to praise the Lord. He wasn't making it up because everything that is created by God must honor him. And so, if we say we are into singing ministry and we think it's for our own purpose or just for our church, we missed it completely and totally. I told that music, when it is done God's way, it brings down the glory of God. When it is done God's way, it liberates the oppressed and delivers the captives. When music is done God's way, it opens the prison door. When it is done God's way, it turns our night to day. When it is done God's way, it brings victory and deliverance from the powers of darkness and freedom from captivity of the enemy. The children of Israel praising God brought down the wall of Jericho. I told you, if you were here earlier, without any physical weapon. With Paul and Silas praising the Lord, there was an earthquake. And the prison doors were open. With Israel praising the Lord, the enemy coming in battle were all defeated before getting to the battlefield. There is power in praise. There is power in praise. And the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. We need to understand that music is an integral part of worship, not just in church, but in life generally. The first mention of music in the Bible is in the book of Genesis, chapter 4, verse 21. Genesis, chapter 4, verse 21. And his brother's name was Jubal. He was the father of all such as handle the harp and the organ. That was the first mention of music in the Bible. And Jubal was acknowledged as the first one ordained of God, endowed by God to be a man of music. The gospel music experience cannot be told in a short story or even in a melody of song, because it is too far-reaching, far too harmonious, and deliberately stimulating. It is a living experience, always changing, always giving, and always becoming the foundation that gave moral physical and spiritual support to a great and powerful people. Gospel music. It's a shining beacon of hope, a fantastic journey of joy divine, and a triumphant victory in God that comes from deep down in the souls of God's chosen people. The greatest melodies and the most stimulating songs have been given to this race, to humanity in general. And the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Music is so important and so powerful that it honors God. It moves God. It spurs God into action. Listen to this. Music has touched the lives of men, either negatively or positively. But understand, we are concentrating on gospel music. Music in the church. And that's why when we sing, we want to differentiate the difference between the secular music and spiritual music. We want to distinguish the difference between the music for self-glorification and the music for God glorification. Because music is so powerful that, pay attention here, even the little baby understands the power of music. When you carry a baby in the hand and the baby is crying, mothers, what do? You sing. And as you begin to rock them and you sing, what do? They respond. That is the power of music. The power of music. The Lord will help us. As we look through the pages of the scripture, we see quite a lot of people following in the steps of Jubal. And that is why, as soon as Israel crossed over the Red Sea, the first thing that Moses did was what? To sing. To sing. Singing lifts the spirit up. Singing draws the attention of God. Singing connects the mortal man with the immortal God. Singing prepares us to receive from God. Singing makes us a better person in the sight of the Lord. Singing reveals us to ourselves. I'm not sure if you have been there, that you are singing, and the song is a message to you, and you break down in tears. I'm not sure if you have been there, that you are singing, and the singing gets so emotionally connected with God, and you still break down singing. Years back, I remember, I went somewhere, and then I was listening to the song, "Take Me to the Place Where You Are. I want to dwell daily in your presence." I was in the car. I parked by the roadside. And I listened and listened and listened. And the more I listened, the more I sob. The more I listened, the more I pray. The more I listened, the more I cry. That is the power of music. By the time it was over, I saw myself better than before I started singing. I became more humble. I became more serious because there is power in music. In Exodus chapter 15, verses 1 to 21, we're not going to read, you can read on your own. After Deborah conquered Jabin the king and his captain Sisera, what did she do? She sang unto the Lord. In Judges chapter 5, Amen. That's in Judges chapter 5. And then when you now come into the New Testament, I told you about Paul and Silas. All that happened. So, looking at all this, I told you earlier in the morning, pay attention, I want to repeat myself again, that music, singing, is not secondary to the office and the ministry of preaching. Singing, I told you earlier this morning, transcends the time of life. When preaching would have come to an end and all that has to do with preaching is over, singing continues. Preaching is to humanity, singing is unto the Lord. And that is why, after we are dead and gone, when we get to glory in the kingdom of God, singing will still be ongoing. So it's not just a temporary thing. It's an eternal ministry. And that's why I told you in the morning, and if you're in that ministry here and you don't take it serious, you don't think you need to pray as much as the pastor will pray, you don't think you need to prepare as much as the pastor will prepare, you don't think you need to consecrate as much as the pastor will consecrate, you don't think you need to be determined and focused as much as the pastor will, then you are not fit to be in that ministry. And I told you earlier on, this year we don't want to just do ministry, we want to serve the Lord. If the pastor will fast and pray before ministering, I don't care what stage you are in this ministry, you cannot do less. If the pastor is more concerned about the way he talks, the places he goes, the way he acts and behaves, you as a singer cannot do less. The people that God observed the most in the church are the pastors and the singers. The people that God praised the most in the church are the pastors and the singers. The people that God criticized the most in the church are the pastors and the singers. It's a unique ministry. It's an important ministry. And the people that make the most sacrifices in the church are the pastors and the singers. The Lord will help us. Music then is to express and modulate emotion. We use it to soothe, psych up, woo, enrage, sadden, and cheer each other or even ourselves. Music is an especially important tool for bonding with and caring for anybody, everybody, including infants, like I told us earlier on. Psalm 9 verse 2 says, I'll be glad and rejoice in thee. I will sing praise to thy name, O thou most high. O thou most high. Psalm 21 verse 13 says, be thou exalted, Lord, in thine own strength, so will we sing and praise thy power. Psalm 28 verse 17 says, the Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusted in him, and I am helped. Therefore, my heart greatly rejoices, and with my song I will praise him. I will praise him. Psalm 33 verses 2 and 3 says, praise the Lord with harp, sing unto him with the psaltery and an instrument of 10 strings. Sing unto him a new song, play skillfully with a loud noise. Pay attention here. It's not enough for you to say you are coming to sing. You better be prepared. The psalmist said, you do it skillfully. You get yourself trained. You get yourself well equipped and better empowered. You know, some have been in this singing ministry for 10 years. They don't know what voice training is all about. They never invest anything. No time invested. No money invested. No energy invested. No sacrifices made. And then you say you are singing. No, you have not been singing unto the Lord. You have been singing unto yourself. And that is why if people out there could sing and we buy their music and we enjoy them and we feel happy, what you have been singing, can anybody buy it? What you have been singing, has anybody felt blessed by it? Has it changed any life? Does it lift up any soul? Because there is no preparation. And that's why, even though we have a lined up training session for all the various aspects of work church in the church, whether you're in the electronics department, the children's department, even all you do is just to count money, everyone must be trained. But choir is very important, and that's why you are the first on the line. And the Lord will prepare you in Jesus' name. Look at that Psalm 28 again, 33 rather. It says, praise the Lord with harp. Praise him with harp. Praise him with harp. Sing unto him with the psaltery and an instrument of 10 strings. Sing unto him a new song. You know, I told the pastor over here that all the members of the choir must learn to play one instrument or the other. But you know, some of them, they say, well, I don't want to play. At this age, I don't have time to learn. And they quit. You know why they quit? Because they don't understand their calling. They don't know the purpose of singing. They don't know the place of instrument in music. There are times in the scripture that when, just look at Jehoshaphat. They were going for battle. These were people that knew the power of music. He called the singers, and they came with their instruments. And as they were playing and singing, the power of the Lord came down, and then the enemy was dealt with over there. When David had an issue, and not only David, Elisha too, they would just say, bring me the minstrel. And as they began to play the minstrel, the Spirit of God will come down. Do I tell you this? Many a times in my house, or on the road, even though I don't know how to play stuff, but what I know to do, I do it to invoke the Spirit of God. If this is what is available for me, I will beat it as drum. And it changes the environment. Check out my daughter. I'll be driving on the road. We are singing. My steering is what I could lay hold on, and I will use it as drum. In the house, we're having devotion. The dining table is what we have. I turn it to drum right there. I don't really know. But I can put things together and it changes the environment. But now this is your ministry. This is your calling. And we say, to honor God, to glorify God, you must be trained. Amen. We need to know and understand that Christian music must be distinct and different from that of the world. If you know the purpose of it, music does a lot of things. I told you some of them already. It rejoices the heart of the Lord. It rejoices the heart of man also. It encourages. Music encourages. Music assures. Music corrects. Music convicts. Music converts. Music converts. Music converts. 2 Kings chapter 3 verse 15. I told you about Elisha. I told you about David also. 2 Kings is going to tell us about the mystery and what happened when the mystery came. I didn't say mistress. If you call it mystery or mysterial. Isaiah chapter 3, verse 15. And Solomon awoke, and behold, it was a dream. And he came to Jerusalem. Second Kings. Second Kings chapter 3, verse 15. And Elisha said unto the king of Israel, what have I to do with thee? All right, thank you. I jumped to verse 13. All right. Are we all there? Because I am now there. Amen. But now, bring me what? A mistral. And it came to pass, when the mistral did what? Played. What happened? That the hand of the Lord came upon him. It came upon him. The hand of the Lord. That is the power of music. The power of music. It honors God. It gets the attention of God. It glorifies God. It prepares the heart of man to hear from God. Because it softens the heart and makes salvation easy. It draws and connects the mortal man with the mortal God. It sobers the heart and humbles the simple. Music. When God done the way of God, gladdens the heart and restores hope to the hopeless. When it is done also in an ungodly way, the tempo of music, the beat of music, the intensity of music, and the lyrics of music could dull your spiritual sensitivity and disconnect you from God. And that's why some people that used to play in the church, they end up in the world. They're under another spirit. But I need to tell you also that music, whether in the church or out of the church, if it is not done God's way, could lead to pride, self, glorification, self-honor, self-gratification, self-justification. You heard a lot about self during the GS message. So then, in order to do it God's way, what must we do? Point number two, preparation for God honoring music. We must do it tenaciously, because the preparation for singing should be taken serious. We must do it by getting trained. Tenacity must be there, training must be there. We must give it the time that it takes. Singing right takes time. We must do it for the purpose of transforming lives. We must do it transparently. At least it must be clear. Clarity. Many a time some people are singing, you can't put together what they are saying. They are not communicating. They are not ministering. In order for us to be able to do all this, because unbelievers, everything I have told you, the tenacity, the training, the time, the transforming, the transparency, the unbelievers, they do all those things. The worldly musician, they do everything. What makes the difference between you and them? Now pay attention. Number one, there must be provable, genuine experience of salvation. If you're not born again, and some of you, you've not been in deeper life, you've been wherever, but just because people heard you sang and you sang beautifully well, they say, oh, come and sing, join the choir. That is not enough. You may sing yourself to hell. You must be born again. Matthew 5:16 says, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. John 3:3 says, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot do what? See the kingdom of God. And going further, we are told that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but cannot tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the spirit. So you must be born again, genuinely born again, sincerely born again, heavenly approved born again. If the Spirit of God bears witness with you, then you are born again. If there is condemnation in your heart, something is wrong with your salvation. Number two, there must be regular attendance of church meetings. Church services. Pay attention here, please. Bible study, you were not there. Revival services or prayer meetings, you were not there. Workers meeting, you are not there. The only day you came is Sunday. And all you want to do is sing. It doesn't work that way. And that's why we have all kinds of things going on in our churches today. And it's part of why we have unbelievers singing in our choir. People with demonic spirits and activities singing in the choir. Carnal people singing in the choir. Because there is no genuine experience of salvation, you are in church one way, you dress one way, by the time you go out there, you are a different person. All that is good with but you is just that you sing. But God is far from you. Faith comes by hearing and the hearing of the word of God. We want to get serious. If you don't have time for the word of God, what then do you want to give to us? Singing. You're going to poison us. You're going to kill us. You're going to destroy us. Enough is enough. And that's why, please, if you are pastor, choir leader, or whatever, if your member choir member, whoever they are not here for this meeting, automatically they cannot sing. I came from a background where training is very, very crucial. Very, very crucial. Before you get to any department in the bank, you must be trained. While you are in that department, you get retrained. And if you look at the American environment, professionals, there is a, what do they call your the course you do? You do recertification. Not because you have your certificates, not because you have not been doing the job, But you do recertification. And that is why deeper life, I thank God, I came from the bank, I came into deeper life. Or maybe from deeper life into the bank, whichever one came first. Deeper life, training, 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 training. And so, don't just go back and say, well, you couldn't make it, sorry, no problem, continue singing. No, you couldn't make it, you cannot continue to sing. And that's part of why I said the pastor should be here. So they know what we are giving you, and then they know what to follow up with in your churches. He said, but pastor, what then do we do in the church with no choir? And I can tell you, I've been leading churches with no choir. What do? We sing the hymn. I don't care how big your church may be, you go back and sing the hymn. You sing the hymn. You sing the hymn. When the people know the essence of what they are doing, the value of what they are doing, the importance of what they are doing, and the honor it gives to God, and they are ready for training, we train them, and then they go back. We train them spiritually, we train them physically. We train them on the job as well. Somebody say amen. And I say this, if you are here in DC and you came after 10 today, you are stopped from singing. Because if people could come from North Carolina, come from Atlanta, come from Philadelphia, and they are getting here before you. When I say DC, I'm talking about DC and its environs. You cannot sing. I need to talk with you to know why you couldn't make it. This is an information we've sent out since last year. We want to get serious this year. This is a year of turning point. Amen? And those of you from outside that came late, I just want to appreciate the fact that you came, but please, it's not tolerated. What is worth doing at all is worth doing well. If people come in just for inauguration, most of them will not even be seen or known. Just to watch what is going on, have come. Some of them came, they paid $1,000 per night for a hotel. Some of them, $600 for just a house. They are to stay for one night. Just to be on time. And we will never take God serious. And we will never take God serious. I will take God serious. I said, I will take God serious. Let's get serious. And if you're from Baltimore area, last year, some of you didn't show up. And I stopped you. Pikesville, Baltimore, what's the name of the other place? Aberdeen. And well, thank God many of you came early today. And if you didn't come early from any of those areas, I need to see you. And I don't even know why our pastors are coming late too. What is worth doing at all is worth doing well. It's worth doing well. Let's get serious. We are all saying the church is not growing. The church is not growing. We are praying. And I can tell we are praying in this church. But if we are praying and we are not walking towards it, we won't get the results. The two must go together. And this year is a turning point year for us. In the name of Jesus. Regular attendance of church services. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 to 3. Wherefore, laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisy and envy and all evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby. If so be, ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Acts chapter 10, verses 16, 17. For Isaiah said, Lord, who have believed our report? So then, we need to understand that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Hebrews 10, 25. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as a matter of form some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Number three, we're still on the preparation. We're still on the preparation. Conviction and commitment to the church's basic beliefs and doctrines as taught from the Bible. Convictions and commitments. It's not just that you come to church. Some are coming, they don't believe in what we believe. And that's why I think pastors, once in a while, we need to just re-interview the people again. Do you still believe what you claim you believe? There must be conviction. There must be commitment to the beliefs of the Bible that are taught in the church. Titus 1:9 says, holding fast the faithful word as he had been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayer. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 15 and 16, meditate on these things. Give thyself wholly to them, that thy prophecy may appear to all. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this, thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. Please understand that we are preparing people for heaven in this church. I need a better amen. You know, the way I'm talking, the way we talk in this church, other churches don't talk that way. You know, about 2 weeks ago, I visited a family. Somebody, a member of the church, was sick and staying with the daughter. And we got into discussion, and the daughter was saying, I was born and raised in Deeper Lie, although I'm not really living it. It's unfortunate. But this is where I'm going. She said she's been to this church. I don't want to be mentioning them because this is on tape. Big church, known church, popular church. And she told me things going on in that church. And she said, although I am like this, but what Deeper Life sowed into me is still in me. And then she left the church, went to another church, and told me, and this other church, supposed to be a gospel church, and I even know the pastor very well. And if I mention him, many of you will know him. And he said, this church, they will tell them gospel church. Not in Africa, in America. Here in Maryland, we tell them to bring salt, to bring oil, to bring pots, to bring stone. Which church, you know, does things like that? She said, she told us that something is wrong here. And the church is growing. They have Jesus plus something else. Plus something else. Gospel church. Gospel church. You know, recently somebody called me, I won't tell you details of that, and said, Pastor, we've heard about this pastor, we've listened to his message and this and that, and then we need to invite him for this. I said, but he was down. Nothing is still exposing, showing. You are a deeper life where we preach holiness, where we preach righteousness. You are not even on stage bending. All it takes is for your brother to come around you and everything under is there. What are you doing? How many people do you want to send to hell in the church or from the church before you go there yourself? You must be well dressed. You must be well covered. I was sharing with somebody. I said, all the time I was home, back in Africa, I never had an issue with sisters' clothing not being well sold. And some of you were choir back home. Now you came to America. And the spirit of this land has gotten over you. In the name of the Lord, we cast the spirit out. Yeah. It's the spirit of Adam. The spirit of immorality. Because you see singers here, they almost could do all their singing and everything naked. And you too, and some of you, you go and buy skirts that we don't even know whether it is from the marine. Or from wherever, and you wear it. When you dress, look at yourself. Do I look like a believer? Without preaching, without telling anybody I'm a Christian. Do I look like a Christian? Do I glorify God? And that's why I said, not just because you're in the choir, but as a believer. But understand also that people see you more often. You know you are tall and your skirt is ending here. Nobody hears all the songs you sang. What are they going to be seeing? You are a distraction to the church. It's part of planning. It's part of preparation. Or you said you are in the choir and then you went, I don't know what name they call them, this kind of skirt that is shaking like this. And then as you are going to the pulpit, what's going on? Examine yourself. Whether ye be in the faith. Examine yourself how that Jesus Christ is in you. Know ye not your own selves, except ye be reprobate, incorrigible. I don't have this in my outline, but let me give it to you as bonus. The book of Peter's. Second Peter chapter 2, verse 14. Second Peter chapter 2, verse 14. I want you to open there and mark it in your Bible. It says, having eyes full of adultery, and that cannot cease from sin, beguiling unstable souls, and heart they have exercised with covetous practices. What's the last statement? Cursed children. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Don't do the things they do. Don't act the way they act. Don't dress the way they dress. Don't some of you still have your jewelries in your vanity box? And yet the Bible says vanity upon vanity. All is vanity. And then you come here to sing Amazing Grace. No, it's not Amazing Grace you are singing, it's Destroying Grace. You must be born again. And some of you that are campus students, I've seen some of you. Your gown. Your dressing. Understand the promiscuity, the immorality, the carnality of this age, mostly
originate from the campus. And I know you see all those all the time. And if care's not taken, you don't even know what is right and what is wrong anymore. That is why you have another spirit. Another spirit. 1 Samuel chapter 10 verse 6. 1 Samuel chapter 10 verse 6. You need to pray that God will give you a new spirit. A godly spirit. So that you can be a different man, a different woman. But the spirit of the Lord, and the spirit of the Lord will come upon thee. Somebody say amen. Amen. And thou shalt prophesy with them. You will sing with them. Singers are prophets. And shall be turned unto, what's the next statement? Another man. When the spirit of God comes into you, listen to this. Anything I'm telling you today, I didn't get them from deeper life. I got them when I got born again. With nobody teaching me. Nobody teaching me. But the spirit of God that came into me. If you've heard me, I always call myself a spiritual orphan. No spiritual father, no spiritual mother. Until God eventually led me to a deeper life. But all these things I already knew. I already gave up without any preacher because of the spirit of the living God. And I tell you, sometimes I talk with my children. You know I have four girls. And I said, listen to this. I'm not telling you anything because of deeper life. Deeper life is a church here on earth. I'm talking about eternal glory. I'm talking about heaven. And whether you stay in deeper life or not is your choice. I made my own choice. But this is the way of heaven. This is the way of salvation. And whoever listens, whoever doesn't listen, I stand with God. I don't know about you. And some of you, because this is my daughter, whether living right or not, she must be there. This is my son, he must be there. You are disqualified. If others by God's standard are not qualified, your family member by God's standard are not qualified. Somebody say amen. Am I communicating today? There must be accountability. 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 Some of you cannot come for practice, cannot be at the meeting. And you don't think that the choir leader, the choir master, the choir mistress is important enough for you to take permission. You just take off and you just go. After all, who is she? After all, who is he? After all, I'm old enough to be your mother. Congratulations. Do I tell you a good news? Joe Biden was old enough to be Barack Obama's father. Joe Biden was already in the Senate where Barack Obama, as a little boy, was still playing ball on the street here and there. And he came in to answer Obama, "Yes, sir." What's the name of David's father? David in the Bible. Jesse was David's father. David became the king. Jesse had no choice than to submit to his own son. What's your problem? And you say you are born again. And all that is still in your head is, I am older than him, I am older than her. You are carnal. You are sensual. You are not saved yet. Because if you are, whoever God puts there didn't put himself or herself, you give the person the honor the person deserves. That's why we're having all the trouble we're having. And then sometimes we form a clique within the same choir. This one is my own group. Which one is your own group? If you are genuinely born again, sincerely born again, that kind of spirit will not be there in you anymore. And if you're a leader and then you are thinking about, okay, this one is my person, that one is my person, you are preparing to fail. Amen? If you're a Ghanaian and you are the leader and the people that are serious are Ghanaians, what do? Put them there. And if Ghanaians will not be serious with you because they think, okay, you are my kinsman, we are the same person, what do? Get rid of them. All you want to do is to make God number one in your life. You know, some of us, it's like it's a matter of do or die. I must be there. You don't have to be there. I don't have to be here. Listen, check up with people with me here in DC. I run this church in such a way that if for any reason, anything happens today, and I'm not here, this church will not suffer for 1 second. Because it's God that puts me here. So why should I run the church in such a way as if I'm not here, everything should collapse? God forbid. God forbid. God forbid. God forbid. It's the church of God. Let's honor God. Amen. There must be accountability. Honor those that are over you. That's when God will honor you. And I said this, some of you are suffering now as leaders in your department because of what you have done to your own leader before. So, it's a payday. But if you will repent genuinely, God will forgive you. Now, I heard of a pastor sharing the testimony of his life that when he was a worker in a church, whenever they say they want to do something for the pastor, he's the one that will stand against it and say, no, he's getting too much. He's this and that. Then, after many years, he wasn't in that church again. Actually, he came to deeper life. And then, whenever they say they want to do something for him also, and then he remembered his past. So he made an open confession that I am being judged for my sin. What I did to my own leader is what they are doing to me. You better repent. When you honor your leader, and we don't know that these things are very, very crucial, very important, very important. Do I share this with you? I was on house fellowship leader. House fellowship leader that you take to be nothing, when by the grace of God, God has been wrought a miracle through me. You know why? Because the people I was leading honors the God in me, accepted my leadership. So when I say in the name of Jesus, it happens. When they have issues, they don't even worry going to call the area leader then. Listen, I've said this before, I'm going to say it again. It is the person's ministry that you accept that is a blessing to you. And I'm saying this to say that even within the choir, that choir leader, how do you call it now? Choir mistress, choir master, they are endowed with power. You don't believe it? Do you? They are endowed with grace. If you honor the God in them, you will see miracle from them coming unto you. Pay attention. God needed people. You know what he did? He took of the spirit of Moses and he gave it unto 70. And Moses was still not diminished. And then there were two people outside of the camp, and then the spirit fell upon them also. And some came and said, hey, we saw two people. Moses said, are you jealous for me? Some of us, our problem is jealousy and envy. God will help us in Jesus' name. Amen. The third point is the power of music in the church. Of course, I have said a lot about that, so I'm just going to say this in 2-3 minutes and close the meeting. We need to understand that desperate circumstances control the lives of man. Despair and hope, life and death. But gospel music mirrored our predicaments as a collective group of people. It reflected upon our social status and eventually reverberated in our made-up minds that God was indeed on our side. Somebody say amen. I already told you that singing is as good as what? One more time. Singing is as good as what? It's as great as what? It's as important as what? Preaching. Preaching. Why do we preach? The same reason why we preach is why you sing. Anytime I see somebody singing, I honor them because I see them as, whether you're a man or woman, I see them as colleague in the ministry. Amen? I see you like the forerunner of Jesus Christ, John the Baptist, preparing the way of the Lord. And those of you here in DC, when choir sings and it doesn't come out right, what do? I get right away, I get me a hymn. Right away, I get me a hymn. Because I need that preparation before preaching. You know, there was a time here, they praised worship, they sang, and it didn't come out well. I don't know what happened. And I got up there. And I said, that is for you. And then we began to sing. And the keyboard people were playing keyboard and all the rest. I didn't prepare. I didn't know that was going to happen. But I just felt we need something better. We had pews here then. There was a family that came from Ibadan. They were sitting somewhere around here. At the end of the service, they came to me and said, Pastor, when you came up and you were leading the song, my wife got healed. Power of singing. When we were in Upshaw, those of you that have been with us, from generation. Sister Kate, you know what I'm talking about? When we're in the match box. Amen. When I was trying to, because I believe in training, I wanted our people to know what praise worship was about. That it's not just getting there and then singing Wulabaloo. And so I spoke with a young man then, and I think Pastor Charles, he wasn't a pastor, he was still very new and young in the church that time. To cut a long story, we invited a brother from another location that I know he does praise worship very good. If you were in our first convention in 2003. So the brother came. Pay attention here. He came on a Saturday. Even though he had his friends here, very young brother, very, very young, maybe in his early 20s, but very serious. He did not spend time playing around, joking around with his friends. You know what? I was observing every move. That was my closest encounter with him. He was busy praying all through, preparing for Sunday ministration. Sunday morning, he got to church early enough. I saw him on his knees. That was not when he was now trying to start putting Amazing Grace together. He was on his knees praying. You could see the seriousness. You say you are young and you are not serious for God. And then the time came for him to minister. If you know that place was just like half of our overflow. Am I right? This young man began to minister. And the Spirit of God came down. And after the meeting, somebody came to me and said, Pastor, this person ministers so powerfully. And by the grace of God, I can testify I got healed today. He wasn't the pastor. He wasn't our member here. He just came that one day. And by God's grace, he got into the midst of the ministration in singing. When everybody got engrossed, the whole place was charged. The singing was going on. And he began to say, a young man in his early 20s, you are there, you have this problem. You are there, you have that problem. And he was declaring the name of the Lord. And that day, somebody came and said, I got healed. The power of God is resident in you. If only you let God manifest himself and glorify his name. That is the power of the gospel. I told you earlier on, it convicts, it converts. It corrects, it commends. It enables us to consecrate ourselves and be more committed. It gives us courage and confidence. Singing brings healing, brings deliverance. It brings challenges. It challenges us. It lifts up the weary. It brings hope. It brings deliverance. Victory over the battles of life. What can song not do? Let us pray. Examine your own personal self. I'm sure God has dealt with a lot of things in your life. Understand the purpose of singing is not about you, it's about God. It's not even about our church, it's about the glory of God. Understand the purpose of singing is to honor the Lord, to glorify the Lord, to connect you with God, to connect men with God, to convict people, to convert people. Understand that God inhabits the praise of his people. Are you equipped for this ministry? Are you empowered for this ministry? Do you value this ministry? Do you honor the people that are leading you? Do you appreciate them? Do you submit unto them? Do you follow their leadership? Or are you competing with them? Are you looking at them as being inferior to you? Even if you think you know better than them, please submit. The leaders of our nations are not the smartest people. The leaders of our lands are not the most intelligent, the most brilliant, the most educated. And the pastors in our churches are not the oldest in our churches. They are not the oldest by age. They are not the oldest in the church either. It is God that appoints. It is God that approves. It is God that anoints. Honor them that have the rule over you. They will give account for your soul. You don't want them to do that with grief. And if you are the choir leader, you submit to your pastor as well. The pastor receives from the Lord for the church. Remember, whatever you are doing as a choir leader, you are supporting the ministry of the pastor. Yes, your work is not less important, but you are a support ministry. Two captains don't pilot a ship at the same time. Two captains don't control the airplane at the same time. Obey them that have the rule over you. If the church says this is the way, you don't tell your own choir people, no, this is our own way. And you don't come up with attitude. You don't destroy the church. Or else the purpose of singing will be defeated. The power of singing will be deflated. And souls will not be converted. Are you genuinely born again? How's your heart? How's your life? How's your dressing? How's your preparation? How's your training? Jesus, now we pray. Father, we thank you for this moment. We pray you be with us and bless us. Keep us, even as we be our best for you. That your plan and purpose for our lives will be fulfilled. Lord, for as many that have gone wrong or done wrong, or today repenting of the things they have done, the way they have done them, Lord, forgive them in Jesus' name. Prepare us all for eternity to come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right. What we're going to do is